A program note for everyone out there. We are number one on Shoutcast for any talk show. About 18 or 19 rated total for Shoutcast. Hundreds of thousands of people every hour tune in to listen over the internet just on that system. We have over 100,000 people a day downloading the free podcast at Infowars.com. That's recorded here in-house. So if there's any blurps or internet outages that happen occasionally as we get more and more traffic and beef up our system, you will not hear those problems generally in the podcast. So subscribe to that to listen how you want, when you want, where you want. Now, obviously, with over 60 AM and FM affiliates, and we've just gotten three or four more in the last week, so it's actually growing. I need to revise the list. Probably over 70 stations now. That's where the lion's share of the audience is. You could have hundreds of thousands per station with a station like News Radio 590 KLBJ or 1330 that covers half of Texas that's up in Taylor, or a KCAA that goes into San Diego and places there in California, or a KCXL. We've been on about 9 years in Kansas City, covering that entire city and surrounding areas out of Liberty, Missouri. But the shortwave is great as well as a world service we do for everybody. We have satellite systems people can listen over, several different satellite systems. It's all very important, but the internet is special because it puts us everywhere. You know, you can tell your friends, your family, your neighbors, even if you don't have a local AM or FM affiliate, or even if they don't, hey, you can listen at Infowars.com, or you can listen at PrisonPlanet.com. And that's what's so great about the web. It is basically everywhere in the industrialized world, and now even in the third world and old world. And so that's why it's so important. And yes, we've had hundreds of calls about, you know, whenever our connection to our big servers goes down, James Bond music will play for 5-10 minutes. That is our servers going down. The problem is, too, if we don't have it on these server farms and CDNs, when it goes down, then that basically knocks out our Shoutcast rating, and we like being number one on there because we get new listeners that way, but we're just going to have to give up our ranking because the number one thing is getting the message out and split the streams up into dozens of streams, not just five or six big streams. Also, there's other ways to listen. We have tens of thousands every show that listen on the Windows stream that comes out of another server system, and people are now using that a lot. And, of course, that's an unrated stream. That's an internal stream. But you can go to Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com and click on the Flash Player window to listen that way. If you hear outages on the Genesis streams, because those get maxed out, or on the Infowars streams, we have that window stream there for you as well. Because the internet is so important, because it's a key place that we virally spread the message, then YouTube videos, live leak videos, people make hundreds of videos with audio from the show, you cut it up, you condense it down, all of you out there doing a great job, so please keep that up. Okay, without further ado, I'm really excited to get to introduce to you Peter Joseph. Peter Joseph, of course, made Zeitgeist, which I would say is the second most viewed video just from my analysis in internet history. I would still say that Loose Change is number one, but that's because it's been out longer. In the future, it remains to be seen, but the two films definitely are the most viewed in viral history on the internet. And the maker, Peter Joseph, has now made a Zeitgeist addendum, another two-hour film, very well done. He works in professional TV. And he did this on his own, though. It's excellent. And he went out and actually did a lot of interviews and things for it as well, not just internet clips that he combined for the first Zeitgeist. And I agree with about 90% of what is in the film. I think that the interpretation, the subtle way it's put out, people are going to misinterpret a lot of it. That was my point criticizing some of it earlier in the week. I also think that it's another form of orthodoxy to make fun on a high horse of religious groups and people who are religious. Because, you know, the human mind, human sight and smell only picks up a very narrow spectrum of reality. That's been scientifically proven. Is there a lot of quackery and superstition and kooky stuff going on out there? Certainly. And that's why I get away from, you know, organized religion myself. But I think that in a way it actually divides people that both films have decided attacks on religion, especially Christianity. And I'm allowed to have that, you know, view and say that I don't particularly agree with that. I don't hate Peter Joseph because of his views. I don't look down on him. I don't even judge him. I just am allowed to have my view I think that that is itself a little bit closed-minded. That doesn't mean that I buy into every superstition out there. And conversely, people like to start fights between any, you know, big alternative media movement icons or films. You know, I have a lot of zeitgeist people that attack me and say horrible things about me, and they're not zeitgeist people, but people that are followers of the film or use the name as a maxim or a logo, kind of like the shingle or the flag they fly. And then a lot of folks who call themselves Alex Jones listeners who viciously attack Zeitgeist because of its anti-Christian bent. And then that's probably why the Zeitgeist folks are attacking me, and then my people are attacking them more. And then then that kind of creates with myself a subconscious disliking for it, because then I get attacked by a lot of extreme close-minded Christians and Muslims and religionists out there who get mad that my footage is in Zeitgeist. He put it in there first, and later he said, hey, can I use it? And I said, fine. And he has the rights to use the footage that he has in the first Zeitgeist now, because I'm actually for open discussion and things being out there, and a lot of people found my work because of Zeitgeist. So, you know, I believe that we can take good out of even things that I see as not effective or true in Zeitgeist itself. So with that said, as my opening statement, I want to bring Peter Joseph up on the air and let him have an opening statement about himself, Zeitgeist, and where all of this is going. Peter, great to have you here.
Thank you, Alex. I appreciate you having me on. And I'm glad you pointed out what you did. I think a lot of people listening to this cast are going to, you know, sit there waiting for some type of duke out between you and I. And debate is really an infantile disposition. I think discussion and open discussion is what we need to engage in. We learn from each other, and that's what a society should really be thinking when we engage ideas that are conflicting from one belief system to another. You know, competition, things like this that we think are naturally bred into us, dispositions of winning. These are things I would like to address today. I know you have different dispositions, as you've stated, for example, in your October 8th broadcast. And before I begin any of that, however, since you did bring up Christianity, first thing, I'm not attacking Christians whatsoever. I think anybody who pays attention to what I've stated, as far as the first film, I go into the historical bases of Christianity, and then I linger into the philosophical dispositions and how it's very restrictive of the human mind. In the second film, I detail how essentially the belief system itself is based on a rejection of new information, and this is very important and very difficult to deny when you get into faith-based ideologies. And the whole encompassment, if that's a word, of the second film is to really try to pull people into a train of thought that's aligned with nature. And that's why I present the Venus Project, and that's why I present these seemingly spooky things that people have been conditioned to fear, such as centralization of power, but it's not centralization of power in the orthodox manner that many people think to be true or fearful of, or what history has presented. Because the flaw of our society at its very core is that it has not addressed the root problems of what we're doing. And those root problems are sourced in human behavior, not secret societies or elites or even human instinct. We have to look at the environment and what the environment is producing. And then from there, we'll know the resolution. And that's what I'd like to talk about today with you.
Well, Peter, out of the gates, global warming has become a religion. The environment is important. The load of the earth is important. But technologies, as you and the experts you interview have rightly assessed, we can transcend all those problems. And that is being suppressed by the elites who want to continue a cartel or an oligopoly. But, you know, you talk about the load of the earth and, you know, running things according to load of the earth. Well, the controllers, they're already using that. And saying we are going to, as a technocracy, as a scientific system, we are going to scientifically design society, and we're saying carbon dioxide's bad when that's what plants breathe, and one of the four major elements, light, water, carbon dioxide, and oxygen, that make life possible here. So see, out of the gates, there's that oversimplification. I think it's important to have the discussion. It's just the way it can be interpreted that's a religion too. There is a religious belief that carbon dioxide is bad and evil and a toxic waste.
Yeah, there's also a religious belief that the free market system is the end-all to our progress as a civilization. They're all religious beliefs in their own accord. If they're not addressed in a highly intellectual and scrutinizing manner, the best form of reference for that type of disposition or analysis, if you will, is what you refer to as the scientific method. Everything that we have, well, first of all, let me counter one thing. Essentially, what you're seeing with this ruling elite that you refer to, that, of course, they will use technology against humanity, the microchip, surveillance. We're seeing this rampantly. Why? Because their social system is failing. They have to preserve the structure. At least that's my opinion, and we can go into more detail for that. However, they are totally out of line with nature. So what they're implying will never really work, because it will just produce more instability. The people will eventually rise up above it, because the system is emergent, and we are always learning new things, and things that do not work as the emergence proceeds will be phased out. And this is where social stratification and all of these different elements come into play. You see, I'm not talking about, for example, on your October 8th interview, excuse me, your review of the piece, you implied to your audience that there would be this eradication of the social structure. Remember when you said that? As though that someone's going to come around with a gun and shoot people that are involved in the wrong type of social stratification. That is not at all what this idea is about whatsoever. The eradication notion comes from the disposition that human awareness, human value systems will be altered as the society is culminated in more alignment with nature itself. Now, that's a very difficult thing.
Yeah, well, how do you gauge the alignment with nature, and what scientist or group is going to be able to develop the gauge by which you set up that system?
Well, you can look at it from, here's a very oversimplified example, but it gets the point across very easily. If you have a plot of land and you want to do something with that land, say grow something on it, build something on it, you're going to analyze the topsoil of it. The parameters of that land become self-evident as to what you can do on it. Now, when you apply this to the planet, you begin to see that the resources that the society needs, which can be assessed through surveying what is necessary for the society, has a natural development and can occur naturally without opinion whatsoever, because you're basing it on tangible resource management of the planet. That's why in the film, I keep going back to the same point.
Stay there. We're going to skip this break right now. Here we go. Okay, continue, Peter.
It's the intelligent management of the Earth's resources that's needed. Now, people don't understand what that means. They don't know what that means because they've been so conditioned into this completely artificial structure of money and labor for money, competition for labor, and money for resources. This is a completely fictional disposition. It's a false system because there's nothing but resources. And the ideology that will construct our new world, so to speak, is an ideology based on resource management as denoted through the scientific method. So that plot of land has the resources available. The only way you can have unification, intellectual unification, excuse me, let me back up. The only way you can have an abundance and an optimization of our world is if you understand what the planet has and you gauge all of its resources. This is why an intellectual unification that Jacques Fresco talks about, world unification, it's not world government at all. It's an entirely different ideological disposition based on what's available on the planet, what the society needs. And this is an extremely long-winded conversation. I wish we had more time.
Yeah, but who's going to decide what humanity needs?
The question isn't who's going to decide. It's how will the decisions be made. It's an ideological-based assumption based on nature. There's an empirical order that's been working in nature forever. For example, anything that you have in your studio right now, all the technology is derived from one process, and that's called the scientific method. Our society needs to be completely in accord with this. The parameters are self-evident once you get this train of thought going.
But there aren't going to be people that, quote, want to be in accord, and there's huge debates within the scientific method. And so how are you going to bring something completely into accord or eradicate that?
Well, this is why human behavior has to be understood, which is another very important point that we need
to understand. And I disagree with you that humans are fundamentally, you know, don't have competition in them.
Okay, well,
I mean, that is all over the animal kingdom. That is the name of the game.
Sure, but why? Why does the animal kingdom have this?
Because of resources.
Exactly.
But also because of the design in our development within that system of competition, it is to deny how we were developed and what we have been developed to do.
Well, I would have to respectfully disagree with that because there's no basis for that. Everything that we have that we think is derived naturally as far as human instinct, every form of human instinct that you see popularized by the modern-day alchemists, the geneticists that say, you know, they can find the genetic gene for smoking or the genetic gene to be a Republican. This is completely ignoring basically everything that the environment has been teaching us. For example, if you were taken as a little baby, infant, brought over to the Middle East, dropped off into a family that was Muslim, you would be on the air right now speaking Arabic, praising Allah, and you'd have a show called Info Jihad. It's completely arbitrary to the extent, I mean, I'm not saying that there aren't kernels of elements in our lives that dictate. We want to live.
Wait a minute. It's not kernels. Conservatively, more than half of our activities in motion is genetic and nature, and then nurture is the variant that will change for the time and place and culture how your genetic information manifests.
Everything that we understand has been taught to us in some capacity, especially our operations. Every word I'm saying has been taught to me. Every concept has been relayed in some capacity to me, and through my mental operations, which is a form of conditioning, I have arrived at novel conclusions. My originality is simply because of the environmental influences that are completely and utterly conditioned to me as opposed to everyone else. Everyone is different because they come from different conditioning, in other words. This is extremely powerful, and it's not 50-50. It's probably 90-10. Our conditioning is everything, and when we realize that the monetary system...
Hold on, we're going back to the full audience. Here we go. Talking to the creator of Zeitgeist 1 and now Zeitgeist 2, Addendum, Peter Joseph. Peter, I fundamentally, and we were just discussing this for the internet audience only when we skipped that break, we're back to the full audience now. I disagree with you fundamentally that humans are trained and conditioned to be competitive. All higher species, mammals particularly, are competitive. It is, at its base, a genetic competitiveness to pass on the traits that made the species excel in its environment in our development. And then all the elite does is knows how to manipulate and punch those buttons and condition those and hone those and bring up certain instincts that have manifested through societal developments and to overexpress others and to suppress others that they don't like. And I mean, that's just, I fundamentally disagree with you on that point.
Well, I want to make a comment then that it's for the audience to decide, of course. And I think what people fail to realize, the geneticists fail to realize, what your worldview isn't taking into account are the millions, if not billions of years of evolution based on scarcity. All the animal kingdom has lived within scarcity. You have to have social hierarchy of a pack of lions. You have to have fighting because there's not enough to go around. In the new society,
and you have to have fighting today because there's always going to be corrupt people. But some of the Zeitgeist followers say, I can't even say what evil is because that's my Christian construct. No, it's not. Evil is destroying the planet. Evil is killing life. Evil is hurting the weak and the meek and the small. These are basic rules, you know, that what is anti-life, what is destructive of the tribe, we call evil.
Well, what is evil? Define it for me. What causes evil? What causes someone to behave in an evil manner?
Well, I'm asking you, do you believe evil exists?
Absolutely not, because based on the definition of evil, it's basically a religious connotation. It doesn't mean anything. It's an empty distinction. If I was to redefine it, I'd say evil would be aberrant behavior. And if I was to define aberrant behavior, I would say almost conclusively that aberrant behavior is caused by the necessities of the environment.
But is it aberrant to have a leech through their breeding, through their culture, who are hyper-aggressive and hyper-dominant and sadistic? I call Satanists kidnapping a child and raping them for a month and cutting their heart out evil, because that is evil according to the human code and evil according to us having safe, happy tribes who can go on being scientists and creating, which is the main drive and goal of the species.
Sure. Nevertheless, however, it's always a product of conditioning. The people in the secret societies that you talk about that have grown up with their elitism, they are molded and shaped. Henry Kissinger, George Bush, these men brought up in elite system, they behave in elite ways.
That's right. They sent Prince Charles to boarding schools to be beat up, to be treated bad, to make him a nasty person.
Well, there you have it, and this is exactly my point. So in order to fully change society, in order to really understand what's going on, you can't use these outmoded words. At least in my opinion, I don't like evil because it has a generally religious notion. It denotes a
look,
element.
Here's what I'm saying to you. I've read The Social Workers 150 years ago. I've read The Social Engineers and The Transhumanists and The Posthumanists, and they all say very close to what you're saying about this utopia of the machines getting rid of our competitiveness, but then they bring in a hyper-competitiveness to dominate us. When the social workers kidnap people's kids for no reason, for the state to re-educate them, it makes nightmares. I mean, I've heard all this and people showing me fancy roads and models of spaceships and saying we're going to create a utopia and we're not going to have money anymore. And then what is money versus this monetary system you talk about with banker and fractional reserve manipulation?
Well, first of all, there's no utopia. I want to get this out of the way. That's a loaded term, just like evil. It has no basis. Secondly, the difference between the systems that I'm advocating, versus the fractional reserve monetary system, is multifaceted. First of all, the monetary system, I went into specific detail to talk about how the fractional reserve system enslaves humanity distinctly, with absolute acuteness, because there's not enough money in the money supply to go around. Let's assume that there was.
Yeah, but you're saying it's a system failing. They designed it to consolidate power. It is succeeding according to their aims. You're saying, and your experts are saying, society is going to fail, so we'll have a new, better system or a shot at it. But to them, the drug war, any of it, it's not failing. It is succeeding, and they want to create a collapse to bring in more social engineering and their utopia.
Okay, well, you changed the topic a little bit from what I was talking about, so let me address that. Basically, the collapse is not entirely 100% rigged. What it is a pyramid scheme that is tipping, that they've been expecting for a long time, and of course they're going to capitalize on it. The fractional reserve system has to fail, and that's what we're talking about. The monetary system has to fail because it's based on competition and self-interest. And power monopolies, just like in the second part of Zeitgeist Addendum, where I talk about world monopolies.
Well, I'm going to stop you right there. So you can't even say you're wrong there. They fundamentally design these in endless Ponzi schemes that always sieve out, like a guy panning for gold in a river, the wealth. I mean, they admit it. It's in all their documents. Here we go. We're going to skip this break, too. We're going to skip it right now. I mean, go ahead and counter that. Go ahead and explain to me how it's not engineered by them.
I'm not saying it's not engineered per se. You make these leaps that I can't see how you can honestly stand behind them with 100% confidence. The fractional reserve system, which has been put in place, they knew what would happen to it. But it created such a great level of differential advantage for their control, with the corporate structure and everything else. I don't think they wanted it to fail. This is why the boom and bust cycle is what it is. It's completely contrived. I will admit that to you. But they have a very delicate balance right now because the people, especially in the West, if the system fails the way it should, the way it mathematically should, just like every bust should be about 10 times worse than it really is, but it's not, because that's why the Federal Reserve was created, the lender of last resort.
They always create a new bubble.
Of course they do, and this is the way it has to work, though. It's a natural phenomenon. It's not as rigged as you think it is, because the money has to go somewhere, but they do protect it. And right now we're seeing the top of this pyramid scheme collapse, and I think the elite, even though they have their power consolidation, they know that they have to walk a very delicate line, because the public is going to lose it. They're going to lose control of the public if they allow another depression. The public...
Hold on. I mean, let's go back to what you just said there. The central banks are cutting off liquidity to the real market and the population of the world. They are then, while telling the public the money's going to them, conduiting all of the fiat currency to themselves while it still has some value, while they consolidate real assets. And Business Week and the Financial Times of London properly say that this is actually good for that small inner group of banks to consolidate.
I'm not saying it isn't, Alex. I don't know where you're getting that.
I've got audio clips from the film is where I got that.
Well, if you listen to the first Zeitgeist, I make it extremely clear about the interests of the international bankers.
Look, I overall think your film is healthy and good and thought-provoking and great. It's just that I've always told my listeners, don't make what I'm saying a religion where I'm infallible and question me. And I'm saying, and obviously no work can be complete, none of it can be perfect. I'm hoping here, and I'm sure you've got things you can teach me, to open up avenues of discussion and refinement, not in your overall idea, but in how people are interpreting it. Because certainly you know about the socialists and the Fabian socialists and the engineers, and H.G. Wells and Bertrand Russell and all them, saying about 90% of what you're saying at the end of Zeitgeist Addendum, but overlaying it with government central control to be able to construct it.
Well, I couldn't disagree more. Based on the fact that what has been presented might sound like socialism, it might sound like Marxism because of those kernels of element of having a system that's designed for society as opposed to everyone fighting each other in order to survive in this monetary system-based competition illusion that's been created. The difference is the entire foundation of this is that it's related to science purely. And think about all the early Fabian socialists and all these guys, whatever their intent was, negative or positive, they had no concept of what technology is, and neither does half the people on this planet.
All right, stay there. Stay there. Full audience right now. Here we go. Hey, let's keep this rolling underneath our guest. I'm going to try to control myself and just sit here and write notes. I'm going to shut up for 10 minutes, Peter Joseph, creator of Zeitgeist. And you just run with what you're really saying overall, trying to encapsulate it all, and then I'll come in with some of my primitive musings here. My feeble mind will try to grasp it. Again, I want to say overall, I think your film's healthy and thought-provoking. I think these discussions are important, and people shouldn't allow institutionalized religion or anything to shudder their intellect from trying to grasp the whole width, breadth, and depth of this multifaceted, multivariate universe that we swim in. So, creator of Zeitgeist, you go ahead. You got the floor.
All right. Well, the first thing we need to discuss is the monetary system itself. And the system that is underlying, or the belief system that is perpetuated by this structure. The greatest failure of our society for thousands and thousands of years is to not address the root causes of human behavior. And the monetary system has created one of the worst behavioral complexes that society has ever seen. It is compounding age-old instincts which have very little relevance to progress at all, including things like competition. If I was to ever call it an instinct, I'd say it's a natural culmination due to environment. If you put it into an environment of scarcity where there's no work, no jobs, you're going to be forced to steal. Your aberrant behavior is a creation. It's not inbred whatsoever. And I can defend that on multiple levels, but I'm going to move on to talk about the system itself, the monetary system. It doesn't matter if it's free enterprise. It doesn't matter if it's communistic or capitalistic or socialist. These are loaded terms based on basically outmoded ideologies that are no longer relevant. What we have is a system of competition that's inherently based on the assumption that human beings must fight with each other in order to survive. That's one. The second point is that human beings have to have incentives in order to be motivated to do something. And these are two extremely dangerous and ill-gotten perceptions of human behavior. The first mode, to the effect that human beings need to have incentive, I'll go to that one first, is human beings' motivation can come from many different places. When you're a child, you have all sorts of interests that you pursue. You have all sorts of creativities that you find fascinating. You don't know what money is. You don't need incentive to do something. Einstein and Galileo, all of these great men that contributed, they didn't need money as incentive to do something. This is something they did on their own accord. Unfortunately, the brainwashing of society has forced people into a disposition where they want to be rewarded for what they do, and that means they want monetary compensation. No one will do anything in society without reward, and that includes solving social problems. If you can't make money off of solving a social problem in this system, it won't be done. And that is a very, very sad state of affairs. The first mention that I made, where humans have to fight to compete for labor and income, the scarcity that exists in the system, this is created by the monetary system, not only through the fractional reserve system, but in the very structure itself. You can't have a society and expect progress in civil arrangements, ethics, decency, whatever you want to call it, morality, in a system where everyone is gaining off of everyone else through differential advantage. This can't work, it doesn't work, and it's never going to work. This is why the world is what it is today. Almost exclusively based on this competitive notion that is compounded and perpetuated by the monetary system. And this is the greatest failure that people don't understand. This is why I argue against it. I'm not saying that the Venus Project, and they're the first to admit this as well, is the end all. There's no utopia. But they recognize this core element that is corrupting human behavior, so we have to move out of this system. One of the things that people don't realize about the monetary system, which is very important, I think you should think about this too, at least in this fabled free enterprise system specifically, is that it always leads to corruption. We say that the free enterprise system is, you know, it could be great, it could be pure. You could have a perfect free enterprise system and it would work. Well, there's no such thing as that, because it automatically leads to corruption. It automatically leads to oligopoly and monopoly. It automatically leads to aberrant behavior and power consolidation, because that's the basis of it. That is the guiding principle, differential advantage. In order for society to progress, you have to eliminate this differential advantage and all the social stratification that occurs because of it, all the materialism. We have an advertising system that sits there and tells us that our value is based on what we own, and how we, an artistic representation is our creativity is what we own. Who we are, our identities, are what we own. And this is a colossal and tremendous distortion that needs to be overcome. So the basis of this argument is that we have to have a new system that gets rid of these tendencies. This thing called the New World Order that people talk about all the time, and I actually would like you to come back on the air and answer a question for me, and that is, what is the New World Order as you define it, Alex?
What is the New World Order as I define it?
What is it, this, in a concise definition, tell me what, if you were to explain this to someone who had never even heard of such a thing, in a real concise manner, what is the New World Order?
It is a hereditary clan that rules through the fraudulent fractional reserve monetary banking scam that operates through intelligence systems and shadow governments.
And their goal is what?
Their goal is hyper dominance and to control the past, the present, and the future, to set up a worldwide police state by manipulating people's primitive fears with manufactured terror threats, biological threats, chemical threats. Their end game is to exterminate, most of them now say 99% of the population. The public documents say 80%, and to create then a machine utopia where the elite and their progeny go to the stars. It is a worldwide eugenics cult that is in control of most of the resources on the planet and is eradicating the family and the free market. And then, of course, demonizing the free market by claiming this corrupt system they have is a free market, and are now in the final phases of their worldwide consolidation, their victory, which people are calling a collapse or failure.
And what is the path you think everyone should take to stop this New World Order?
The path is multifaceted. We have to take control of our local political units first. We have to stop the electronic voting machine fraud system. To do that, we have to discredit the system, discredit the corrupt government that all the parties have been bought and paid for. We've entered a very deep a sector of the corruption, on the graph, one of the deepest points in the trough.
Well, what about the people, though? What about these people that are the ones that are perpetuating this? What is your solution for these people? What do we do with these people, so to speak? I mean, what is your...
Well, I don't like bloody French-type revolutions, which then turn into something almost even worse. I think they need to be identified, exposed, and then they need to be tried by juries of their peers. They need to be given fair trials and sent to prison. And then their assets need to be nationalized to pay off all the fiat debts they have created. We need to have a population where we don't restrict Madison Avenue telling us we're inadequate so they can sell us products. We need to become conscious of these motivations and decide with the discernment what is a good advertisement, what is a bad advertisement. In your film you talk about, or some of your experts talk about, how we can't basically in a free market or in a system of selling a vase or selling a car or selling a house or getting our kidney taken out, we can't trust anyone. Well, no, we need to learn to investigate and go to references. And, that's why within the past we had brand names, a sewing machine that was known to last longer and be better. That way, if this is not free market, slave goods coming in from China that fall apart in 5 minutes. And so I disagree with that fundamentally. There's just so much I disagree. Let me stop you. I disagree so much fundamentally, with saying we just can't trust the free market and products and goods because people have a reason to lie to you, to sell you crap because somebody might have something better, and then that stops people from progressing, when it is the limited free market, though invaded and corrupted, monopolies through government help, that have been set up, that we do have societal development, technological development, because people do want gain by their inventions, and they do want the prestige, and it has been our competitive renaissance free market, the yeoman farmer becoming a tinkerer, becoming an engineer, turning loose the native intelligence of the commoners that has created all the amazing things we see around us. But that's the byproduct of making us decadent and selfish in Madison Avenue through brainwashing to secure the elite as they they try to come in with a counter-revolution to take over the renaissance that has taken place. And so they have damaged and programmed the majority of the public. And so we need to, at a cellular level, those of us that are aware, try to wake up our friends, family, neighbors, communities, and at a cellular level, one cell at a time, heal the system with an exponential growth curve towards doing that.
Okay, let's step back to my original question, which was about the New World Order. So basically,
I told you what they are. They are hereditary kings who learned how to go underground.
I'm commenting on this. This is why I wanted to ask the question.
Basically, I thought you were posing it again. You said I go back to my original question.
No. I just want to go back and address it because you've gone on a nice tangent, which I appreciate, but you've moved away from what my original response was going to be.
Well, it's a complex world, takes complex solutions. I'm giving you actually analyzed information, things that have been thought out.
Of course. Well, let's
not general ideas.
Let me comment, if you don't mind. Basically, your assumption then on the New World Order is that you have to have the public to wake up to this elite group that are trying to dominate things, and then you have to prosecute them and put them in jail and take them out, and that will be the resolution as you basically.
That will not be the total resolution, but yes, we have a just like the Nazis, they had to be taken out, or finally the communist Chinese said Mao and his wife are nuts, killing everybody because they made a deal with these eugenicists in Europe. We got to arrest them. We got to arrest his wife.
Okay, well, here's a difference. I know you're going to disagree with it, but I think it's good for your audience to ponder this. The genetic basis, the heredity basis that you assume, is very much unsupported because, as I said, these secret societies are secret societies. They culminate who they bring in, and everyone is conditioned into a particular worldview. But the secret societies are also conditioned in and of themselves. Their conditioning comes from somewhere. And my point to you and to your audience is that the New World Order is not some elite sect of people. If you took out every single person at the top of the so-called...
The system is still there, and more people would step into those places like shark teeth. That's not what I said. I said take the consolidated, because that's how they've been conditioned, that's how the system's been set up, and they are coming from that same mindset. They want that power.
It's the environment, isn't it, Alex? It's the environment.
Well, I never said the environment wasn't part of all this.
I know you didn't.
But I'm saying we as a people are competitive, and you have malfunctioning hyper. I mean, here's an example. I try not to be that competitive and lift people up and bring them in, and then I find out as soon as they think they're a big shot, they turn around and attack, primitively thinking in competition, if they knock me, the king monkey, off in this movement, that somehow that will make them the king monkey. But that isn't the case, because in reality, I'm not even the king monkey in all of this. So I'm saying competitiveness is a good thing overall. It just has to be, we have to be conscious of it, and we have to have rules and parameters in it, and then have a playbook, basically, that societally we agree on, and that we're constantly changing. So I mean, this whole thing of trying to say that we innately aren't aggressive, and that we are. I mean, no matter what culture it is, little girls innately start going and building a camp and start breaking up wood and practicing making dinner. And you can take a girl. I try with my girls, have them play with toy guns and army men and soccer and football. I want tomboys. And you know what? They don't like that. They go directly for the pink Barbie. And it isn't culture because they're not allowed to watch TV.
Well, I think I would have to see those instances and conditions. I mean, I can't relay this enough.
This is ridiculous. Why does a sperm whale go south in the winter? I mean, it is genetic. I mean, why do geese know how to fly according to the magnetic poles? You are saying...
Why do birds build a nest?
Yeah, exactly. You're saying instinct has nothing to do with it. This is
it's imprinting. It's imprinting. The bird builds a nest because it's born in a nest. You took a bird immediately out of the nest.
Oh my God!
This is what science.
How does a garden spider know how to spin a web? I mean, what are you? Let me tell you, bro. You got some major issues that are wrong, and I'm telling you, you're influential. You're influential, and that's a good thing because the alternative needs to become, the majority. And I'm all for this, but I'm telling you, and I'm not even looking to argue with you here today. I'm just telling you. I'm telling you, man. Does the mommy spider teach the spider how to do that? Are elephants? Do elephant bulls fight with each other? For dominance, for the best mate, because they saw their daddy elephant fight.
No, because they live in scarcity, and that's what their instincts. That's what their instincts of survival have to culminate in order to survive. In
Look, you can't take the spider out of the spider. You can't take the man out of the man.
Look, humans are very different from other organisms on this planet. We have the ability to think and create. our instincts can be changed, whatever that means. There are no actual human instincts, and I have tons of science to back this up, especially the human being who is so malleable, so easy for influence. If you don't believe that, take a look at the news and how
you're missing it. I agree with you. I believe that separates us from the rest of the animal kingdom.
And you say the competition and greed.
Hold on. Makes us innately different is that we can transcend and rapidly change, and we are not completely frozen into instinct like animals. I'm just saying that there are those two parts.
There are, but one is very much overshadows the other, and that is the conditioning. That is the environment. We have to change the environment if we expect the world to change. Ladies and gentlemen, you're not going to get anywhere by building more prisons, getting more police, and making more laws.
I agree with that. Well, stop. The social engineers want to put people in prisons because they own them, and they want to have slavery. So this is the way to legalize slavery and say, if we catch you with this compound that's addictive that we ship in, then we're going to put you in our slave pit. You're acting, you and your, because I've been watching your film and watching other people that support what you're saying, and it's the view that the elite are dumb and stupid, and they don't know what they're doing, and they're idiots, and more cops and more prisons aren't going to work. Of course it's working. More people in prison, more slavery, more control. It's working beautifully.
Sure, that's one angle to look at it, but nevertheless, the public is conditioned to think these institutions are actually true and real institutions. And not every stratified element of the prison system are a bunch of elites sitting there talking.
No, the low-level morons that have lost all their other factory jobs and want to work as prison guards in there. You're absolutely right. They've been forced through engineering into that evil economy, that corrupt, that bad, that anti-human, that suppressing. Grabbing some black kid because he was caught with cocaine the government shipped in when he's 14 years old because the MTV tells him it's cool with the bling culture, and throwing him in a tiny cell to now be trained how to be a hardcore criminal. That is evil against the human code of nurturing and growing and training and building and reaching for the stars. There is evil, and I will declare abortion evil. I will declare us special. I will declare us a divine species in the image of God, and I will not let the technocrats or anybody else tell me that, because I know we're going to the stars, and I know our destiny is great, and I know a little black kid having pesticide tested on them till they die is evil.
Sure, but that evil has a source, and that's what you fail to realize. And that source can be addressed through the environment and conditioned out of. And until you realize that, your irrational tirades are not going to help anything. You're going to be...
It's not irrational. It is my instinct with the intellectual overlaid into the animal propulsion system to drive the species and to rally my fellow humans to come out of their cocoons and resist the tyranny.
Yeah, the us against them, of course, the us against them.
There is an us against them. There's always going to be Jeffrey Dahmers. There's always going to be Ted Turners. There's always going to be Albert Pikes. You're always going to need weapons because enemies are always going to come against you. There is going to be no utopia, ladies and gentlemen. We must stop being so trusting. It was talk of utopia that killed 200 million people in the last century. We're going to skip this break. All right, go ahead. You got the floor.
Well, I'm glad we are having a discussion as opposed to a debate, Alex.
It is a discussion.
Well, sure.
You've been engaging in low-level monkey behavior. You've been debating. Don't say I'm the only primitive.
No, I'm not debating. I'm trying to present ideas, but you keep cutting me off and projecting what you think is true.
I'm projecting what... But you know what is true.
Alex, let's be mature here.
Hold on. You're saying that what you're saying is a fact, and I'm projecting what I know to be true.
What I'm suggesting is it's been proven by evidence continuously. You have absolutely no proof that there's going to always...
That's a lawyer statement. I'll give you proof all day. Proof of what? What proof do you seek?
You base your assumption on the fact that we've always lived in scarcity, yet you don't recognize that. You don't realize that the human...
Without that drive of scarcity, our key propulsion system is lost to go to the stars.
No, that's ridiculous. What are you talking about?
Our prime drive is to build, and that comes out of scarcity in our development, needing to have a drive, needing to be restless, needing to build a better mousetrap, a better throwing spear, so that the tribe could survive. I don't think that's fundamentally evil. I think there are subgroups of humans who are predating, engaging in predator activity against their fellow humans, like we are a subspecies that deserves to be fed on. I'm saying that's sin. I'm saying that's crime. I'm saying we need communities of purpose, and I agree with a lot of what you're talking about.
Yes, but you fail continuously to see the fundamental point. And what is the fundamental point? It's human conditioning and not genetics that has the relevant issue here. Unless if you want to maintain this society, say, for example, you want to continue this thing you call the free market, which is probably the most, and I mean monetary system of all accord. Communism, socialism, fascism,
no,
it doesn't matter.
Those are all scams.
Stop interrupting me. I'm not finished. This is the type of thing that people need to understand about the environment. As long as we have a monetary system that is based on people getting advantage of each other, you know, those $29.95 DVD conspiracy combo packs you sell, you know why you have your little $29.95? It's to manipulate your audience into buying it because they don't think it's $30. This is the type of nonsense manipulation that goes on every day that we think is commonplace, and it's a distortion, it's anti-human, you engage in it, I am forced to engage in it on certain
levels.
If you were to get a job anywhere, you are participating in a corrupt behavior because you have to take that work away from somebody else.
No, you're part of a tribe, you're part of a team, it's just the elites don't treat the subgroups like that. Hey, we're coming back to the full audience, and I want to address what you just said in this whole discussion about money, okay? Here we go right now.
Is it getting better? Or do you feel the same?
Is it easier on you now?
Will it make it easier on you now?
You got someone to blame.
You got someone to blame.
All right, our guest is the creator of Zeitgeist.
You
and
one love.
Yeah, he says he's not debating, but he... just engaged in just amazing hypocrisy, and I'm going to finish this and let you counter, if people listening on the internet, you know, saying the incredible, those little DVD compacts, you know, you sell, it's, you know, $29.95 is manipulative, and you know, it's bad, and then you go on to say that what I am forced to sell, you know, exactly, you sell your film, so you have the money for the computers. Let me finish. The money for the cameras, the money to fly places, to interview people, to make an even better film, to pay for your apartment in New York or wherever it is you're at. To do all of this, and I'm not saying that the monetary system isn't a total fraud with fractional reserve banking and fiat currency running a scam or an image, but if farmers want to create their local county or city money that they agree upon on exchanging, that greases the skids of commerce, makes it easier for them to exchange goods, that's something that's needed. And I have done whole shows on marketing and saying, why don't I sell a video for $20? Why do I say $19.95? Because psychologically, the $19.95 sounds like it's somehow less, and plus it's what we're used to in the parameters of bigger advertisement, so it triggers those neural pathways that make people buy. Now I really resent the fact that, you know, I pioneered 12 years ago putting my videos on the web for free, and then even paying with my own bandwidth, not just for free, paying to give it to people, paying to be a slave. And then I pioneered viral videos on the web. I pioneered going up and bullhorning politicians. I pioneered going and taking over press conferences. I had no idea I was doing it at the time. It just seemed most effective. I've done all this. I've given. And then you could say that I'm evilly manipulating people, selling things and how I'm selling it. But then in the next breath, admit you are selling stuff. That is, and I always love it. You know, the futurist and the engineer you interview in your film, you know, Jacques, his house is up for sale right now. His 20-acre compound I saw online. I mean, you know, he's selling stuff. Oh, Mike, but see, when you do it, it's loving. When I do it, it's bad. Explain that to me.
And it's getting really annoying to me. So why don't you step back a second, listen to what I actually said. I said, when you put something online and you say it's $29.95, alone, I don't give a damn about what you're doing as far as this and that. It's irrelevant to the point that I was making. My point is that you are engaging in a manipulative practice. If you want to sell something for $20, put it up for $20. Don't make it $19.95. The entire system is based on differential advantage and manipulation.
I did in the past, and I told
people. You are there to preserve
your... I put it up there. I know. I'm evil. I mean,
you're not evil.
We've heard it. No, no, it's true. I'm bad. I'm selling things. It's true. I've been caught.
It's selling things, Alex. It's nothing to do with selling things. It's the way you go about it. Look, you can sit there and project all day. It's not going to help anything. I'm sitting here trying to explain to you that the financial system creates aberrant behavior. And until you and your audience realize this, nothing's going to change. The financial system, not in the way it's constructed, but the actual underpinning mechanism that guides human behavior in the economic structure that relates to business and everything else, will lead only to corruption, monopoly, self-preservation. You have your own self-preservation.
Why do birds get shiny objects and put them in their nest?
Why do birds get shiny objects and put them in their nest? I don't know. Tell me.
Well, it's not because they're greedy and evil, and Madison Avenue told them. They like the shiny thing. So to say that humans wanting things or wanting a house on a hill because they can see a beautiful vista, to claim that people wanting things is inherently bad, it's just that it's lower on the hierarchy of needs.
That's not what I'm saying.
And if you will do immoral things for things, that's bad. But wanting things...
I'm not putting words in my mouth, Alex.
I'm not putting words in your mouth.
Thank you for
Hey, let me talk to him. We'll stay on air here for a minute. Hey, we're going to have a one-minute break, and we'll come right back to you for the second hour, okay?
All right, Alex.
And we're going to play some clips of Zeitgeist addendum here and get your response to those.
I really appreciate it if you actually let me respond, because I have a very simple train of thought I'm luring here.
Look,
jumping off on cliffs, man. I don't appreciate it.
Hey, Peter, it sounds to me you're another one of these intellectuals who will say vicious, aggressive things and then piss their pants if anybody else... Hold on a minute.
Aggressive.
Piss their pants if anybody else says anything half as mean back to them. Okay, now I'm really going to do a critique of you, and now I'm getting out the fine-tooth comb, so get ready.
You realize that I've said nothing negative.
Hey, listen, here we go.
What have I said negative?
Hey, what you don't realize, I've said 100 times on air that $29.95 is manipulative, and I point out on air it is. So, again...
Well, I'm just making the example, Alex.
Okay, hey, here we go.
Waging war on corruption. Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network.
This all started a couple weeks ago when I watched Zeitgeist Addendum, and I came on air and I said, look, all I know is I'm hearing the same buzzwords, government withering away, eradication of the classes, and we're going to play those clips. And I said, I think these people all mean well, and I think it's all interesting. It's just human nature. And look, human nature, you got two men on the air. And look, he's getting fiery. He's getting upset. That's the passion. That's not evil or even something competitive. That is the tectonic, volcanic fury, spewing out of, Vulcan's blacksmith shop. That's humanity. So listen, I tried to give you 10 minutes earlier just to run. You say I keep interrupting, but you keep making statements at me, so I'm going to make counters. So I'm going to just go. Run with it. You got the floor.
Well, first of all, it's not the passion for me to get irritated and express that irritation. It's the condition that you set up, because apparently the only way to communicate with you is through this kind of WWF aggression that you seem to perpetuate.
Exactly. You've got to sit up there with a big bubble alien head, like in Star Trek, and I'm the dumb Captain Kirk down here. You're like, I am the watcher. You are the...
Yeah, keep it going. Yeah, that's right.
No, you always push yourself. Oh, I'm up here. I'm figuring it out. Yeah.
If you listen to anything that was ever presented in my films, I don't know.
I know. Listen, go, man. You got the floor.
Well, actually, my whole point was to actually discuss things with you, Alex, and I'm going to say a bunch of things, and you're going to come back on, and you're going to project a bunch of other things. So what I will say is essentially what I said before, because your audience is the most important thing here, and that's who I really would like to speak with. Ladies and gentlemen, people, we have to start thinking about root causes of behavior. We can't have these superstitious notions of reality. Religion wants us to believe that there's a good and an evil. This is easy to understand. It's easy to think that some people are just naturally good and naturally bad. This is a sad, sad worldview of humanity. It's perpetuated and consolidated in our mind because the system that's been created continues this bad human tendency. It continues this need for self-perpetuation, self-preservation.
Well, wait, how can you say there's even a bad? I thought there's no, bad, evil, same thing.
I never said that evil didn't exist in the sense I'm redefining the terms, Alex. It's not bad or good. I'm giving it a quantitative nation to make it relevant. It is bad for people to beat each other up, as far as I'm concerned. There is a quality distinction, but it's not evil. There's reasons behind it. When you say evil, you are implying a religious connotation that rejects behavioral conditioning of that person. And every single human being is born. There's no difference between a Gandhi baby and a Hitler baby. I hate to break it to you. It's all a matter of conditioning. Until you address this, nothing's going to change. The New World Order will continue. People at the top will be arrested. We'll have more false flag terrorist attacks. Society will break down into a power consolidation. And even the rich elite will eventually suffer because they are completely out of line with nature. And that's the entire point. You cannot have a system based on differential advantage in society and expect progress. And back to your other point, progress is not money. It's human creativity in science and technology. Everything you have, you owe to science and technology. Everything in your studio right now, the chair you're sitting on.
Oh, that's the human mind.
Of course it is, and that's the beauty of the human being. We have the ability to create something that the animal kingdom does not have, not to the extent that we...
Well, B.F. Skinner said beyond good and evil, and then once you're beyond good and evil, then they say it's okay for them to do whatever they want. But you're not saying that.
Say that again.
Skinner and people talked about beyond good and evil. And then
beyond good and evil.
Yeah, so they
sure.
can. So by any time we try to make a moral judgment, people say that's just religious. Well, hold on. I mean, I know Brahma cattle. Brahma cattle are very aggressive genetically. They're some of the most dangerous type of cows to have. That is genetic. That's not trained into the Brahma cows. We know.
Well,
they've done all sorts of genetic studies, a lot of aggression is genetic, and then it can be taken down or it can be jacked up.
Sure, but I think you'll tend to find, though, there's a lot of discontinuous information, a lot of bad research that's gone into the genetics ideologies. For example, the reason that these cattle might be violent has nothing to do with their genetics, the fact that they're born into this violent herd, and they condition those responses. This is the nature with all dogs. This is the nature, there's a cliche of Rottweilers being mean. This isn't true. It just happens to be that the people that get these Rottweilers do so with a specific intent, and the statistics support that they're conditioned aberrantly.
I think that's a big part of it, but a lot of people have nice, sweet pit bulls and Rottweilers, and one day it bites their child's face off, so I don't understand that. We're going to skip this break, too. Look, in the limited time we have here, I really don't want to make this fight, and I don't want to
You're not acting like you, man. I'm really offended that you're yelling at me because I'm just presenting ideas.
Yelling excitedly here on air, and I want to try to go through some other areas of the film. I want to try to go through some other facets because I agree with you about how the monetary system's working. But are you saying that's basically any system that uses symbols to try to grease the skids of commerce?
No, what I'm saying is that you're using a system of exchange that's based on scarcity and you can't and based on differential advantage. Money is inherently a corrupt behavior-producing element. It can't be any other way because it's scarce, just like everything in nature. This is why the animals behave the way they do in nature for food and what have you. You can't have a system of inherent scarcity and ever, ever expect people to behave in any what so-called ethical...
So what do you propose to replace money? How is this metamorphosis?
Well, this is exactly what we were talking about with the resource-based economy. Money doesn't exist. Money is not real. It never has been. Labor, 90% of the jobs people have today, and I'm talking about employment labor. I'm not talking about human interest in working. There's a big distinction there. I think you got that wrong in your argument.
So how does this start? Where do we get the land? Who gives it? Do you take somebody's land to give it to another group?
Not.
Okay.
Of course not. You're jumping way ahead. You have to get the ideology down first, and then the communication will begin on a vast...
But don't I need to know that if an ideology is going to work good, if I'm going to sign on to it, I need to war game it out historically and try to look at it? Or I just accept the ideology first and then hope it works?
No, you don't accept the ideology first and hope it works. That's a faith-based ideology. What you have is you have intellectual analysis of the environmental conditions of the planet itself, and you begin to restructure society based on what we understand today.
How do we restructure society? That isn't going to have a central
term? Well, first of all, the first thing that I think the natural progression would be to build the first city. As I said earlier, this is a technological development. We have to recognize that everything we have is owed to technology. It's owed to human creativity. So we can create things that relieve us of human labor. I point out this tendency, this clash we have with the labor system and human employment, excuse me, labor system and automation, and this is extremely prevalent. We used to have all factory jobs, now we have a service industry. And a service industry slowly being phased out as well. This isn't some plot of the New World Order. This
really
is a natural element of technology replacing human labor. So rather than be fearful of this, we have to harness it, and we have to utilize technology for what its real gift is, and that's extensions of us to relieve us of different things that we do not want to do or don't need to do or are dangerous to do. And that is a central philosophical point in this arrangement. To build the first city would rely entirely on pure renewable energies, transportation that's completely clean. You know, it would cost more money.
Hold on, here we go, back to the full audience. Explain it to people. Here we go.
Proudly presents The Alex Jones Show, because there's a war on for your mind.
We're talking with Peter Joseph, the creator of Zeitgeist, and then he's now made Addendum. I would hope that some of the Zeitgeist viewers would check out my documentary films, because I know the society is engineered. It's stated, it is called The Scientific Dictatorship. My film, Endgame, Blueprint for Global Enslavement, details just a small part with specifics of what they're doing, how they understand human progression, how they want to phase humans out of involvement with the machines, with the systems, whereas this could be an empowering thing, as Zeitgeist is talking about, and I actually agree with that in a lot of the film. They are using it as a way to say they don't need humans and that we're overpopulated and we're a scourge and we've got to just be gotten rid of. And that's been widely discussed and is being pushed by the leading transhumanists, not the whole movement, and the eugenicist, the crypto eugenicist, and others. And I was asking the fellow we're talking to with his ideas and the Venus Project ideas how we would start. And I actually agree, it would be a model system. A town, a city, an area to be a demonstration of the future and what we could move into. But then I would ask him the question, how do you stop the establishment from trying to move in and block its development, because they're trying to block anything that decentralizes power?
Yeah, it's a very good question. That is not a simple answer. Essentially, the establishment would do everything it could to stop any type of system that was self-preserving in its own way, self-sustaining, excuse me, because you can't get profit off of efficiency, sustainability, or abundance. That's why our system right now, the free market, as we call it, or monetary system, monetaryism, as I coined, will never, ever work, because you can never have a world without war or poverty on a system that's based on differential advantage and scarcity. The profit is made off of scarcity. The limited number of things available makes it more profitable. The oil companies have been raping people all past few years, or continuously since the 1970s, with this general tactic, and it's pervasive throughout the entire system. So, naturally, the establishment will reject this, and I'm very aware of that. That is why, at the end of Zeitgeist Addendum, I have a series of boycotts. When the public begins to wake up to the reality of what's possible as a human species, away from all these ridiculous institutions that have no relevance to anything, then that's when the true awakening will occur. People will try to distort the system. They will try to bomb it, do whatever. Anything could happen, but it doesn't matter, because the system will prevail, because it's based on something true. Not money, not competition, but resources and creativity.
But that's what the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution said they were going to do in China.
Well, obviously it didn't work, and there's probably many good reasons for that, because China is a monetary system too. Look, that's why the world system has to change. That's why the human value system has to begin to understand what's going on. I'm not saying this is an easy thing to do. What I'm saying is that this is the next step. You have to have world unification intellectually to understand the planetary resources and what's capable on it.
But see, then people won't unify, so what do you do about them? They're going to hold it back.
Well, then they make that decision, and they sit in their world. You can have a sadly enough, there's no perfect scenario here.
Oh, there's no us against them?
No, there's no us against them. If someone wants to do something else, they do it. No one's eradicated, as you belligerently put in your October 8th. This is a silly, silly notion. There's nothing.
No, I was repeating. He was talking about classes. Everything would be eradicated.
The human value system adjusting and growing and adapting. That's what he's talking about.
Well, hold on. Let's play that clip. Let me play that clip. That's the clip we were playing last week, John. Which sounds very similar to the H.G. Wells stuff, but not the H.G. Wells clip. It was the clip number 10 is what it's called. Go ahead and play that.
We're such an abominable, sick society that we won't make the history book. That you say that large nations took land from smaller nations, used force and violence. You'll get history talked about as corrupt behavior all the way along, until the beginning of the civilized world. That's when all the nations work together. World unification, working toward common good for all human beings, and without anyone being subservient to anyone else, without social stratification, whether it be technical elitism or any other kind of elitism, eradicated from the face of the earth. The state does nothing because there is no state. Because there is no state.
Okay, I don't think I was saying I heard similar things from the communist and the Fabian socialist.
If you go back to your YouTube clip, you specifically project out to your audience that it's an eradication by guns to the head. And if you don't even try to deny it, Alex.
What I said is that's what I said. I said over and over again in society, we hear all these ideas, similar things. I'm not saying it's the same. And I'm not saying there isn't a lot of value in what you're saying. I'm saying what happens in the process of getting there generally turns out pretty bad.
Okay, well, that's an assumption that you assume, but it has absolutely no relevance to what he's talking about. At the very end of this section, he's speaking idealistically. He's talking about the need and the broad scheme. We are an incredibly sick society. Our value system...
Who's sick? Like evil? Like evil?
No, sick because we're misinformed. We have turbulent value systems. We have distortions like religion. We have distortions like fashion. We have distortions like greed and competition that are pervasive and completely paralyzed.
Let me ask you a question.
Who we truly are.
You're listening.
And that is what he's talking about.
Stop.
You're not letting me finish my point.
I need to ask you a question.
Let me finish my point.
Go ahead.
The point is that he's speaking idealistically. World unification without a state. What does that mean? No one can even think about something like that. It means that the state does not serve the function of any type of state we've ever known. It's not a state of control. Humans are based in a condition of... Humans are deriving their products from a system that is self-generating and self-sustaining, and they contribute to society not because they want money in return or power or any of the nonsensical inventions that we've created. They contribute to society because they understand that the more you give, the more you get.
Well, here's the problem. Here's the problem. Every time people try to have anarchy in groups of bigger than three or four people, always somebody becomes what we would call corrupt, or sick, as you would call them, and starts dominating the others. And so what I'm saying is you're a good guy. I believe you're a nice guy who means well. Other people working with you are, and you know, the experts you talk to, I know, both of them are good guys, mean well, and are very intelligent. I'm saying that there is an oversimplification. Are you feeding in all the factors that you talk about?
Yes, of course we are. No one's ignorant to the current state of things. And by the way, you know, you're sitting there telling me I'm a good guy, right? And off the air, you come on, you tell me that I'm one of these intellectual elites that pisses his pants. Is exactly.
No, that was on air. That was on air, bro.
Well, great.
We've been on air the whole time.
What is this?
Wrong again. That was on air. That we were yelling at each other, and you just said that I was. Stop! Stop!
I'm trying to talk.
Put him on hold for just a minute. Look, I got to tell you something, man. You come on here and you say, like with some vitriol, that I'm bagging as a $29.95, but I'm selling things, and then you admit I'm forced to, yourself. Hey, buddy, you're playing sad and spooky music on your stuff. That could be seen as a form of deception much greater than saying $29.95. I mean, if you want to take the gloves off, I can take them way off here. Okay, I am trying to be nice here, and I understand you're in this view that you're so intellectual and so sweet and loving that you're just this higher pothead alien, and I'm this lower Neanderthal down here. I understand all that. You know, us Texans, I'm crapping in an outhouse out here every 5 minutes. My point is, with you, is that I haven't, been here trying to shoot you down or attack you, and I said on air about the pissing in the pants. Okay, so go ahead.
Sure, fine.
Wrong again.
You're being extremely irrational with this because I haven't said anything to him.
No, I just said I think you're a nice guy and a smart guy, and you came back with an aggressive thing. You came back with a debate point.
I think you're a little bit two-faced on this, and I want to make sure that's apparent that you understand.
No, it was on air, pal. Don't try to say it wasn't.
No, I'm not telling the people on air.
There's no two-face about it, buddy. It's all straight up here.
Okay, well, good. I'm glad to hear that.
Hey, let me ask you a question. Now, earlier in your film, I'm going to play the clip, you're talking disdainfully about religion and money and fashion and the family, and it shows a family. What about those? Tell me about them.
Tell you about what? Would you please clarify?
Well, question? I mean, you're mentioning all these, clearly in the context, all these terrible outmoded things, and I read all the social worker books, how the family's a disease and all this. I'm asking, is the family a good thing, or is it going to go bye-bye too?
Of course the family's a good thing. Family is a natural institution. Family is where people will return to in this type of situation, but there'll be a different association because the family will become the community in many ways. The extensionality that we feel, this thing we call love, is not restricted to your little group or your family.
But love is religious. It doesn't exist either, just like evil doesn't exist.
Love is
because if evil doesn't exist, good doesn't exist.
I never said evil doesn't exist. It's a different terminology. You use it in a religious context very frequently.
I am not.
Well, fine. If you want to use the word evil, I'll just use the word bad as a synonym. There is an element of alignment. There are certain things that we consider to be socially offensive to the structure, and that's where crime and things come in, so you call them bad, naturally. However, a person engaged in that crime is a victim of their culture. Therefore, they're doing what they have to survive, so it's good for them. Therefore, it's all a matter of degree. Coming back to the family, family is whatever the family wants to be. There's no restrictions, there's no CPS in any type of society. These are all amalgams of the corruption that we see, of this human loss, this intellectual distance.
Well, here's the deal. With 6.5 million people, let's say you got your society, you're saying it's just, you're going to be so good that nobody does, you know, these bad things or these sick things anymore. Where does the word eradication come in then? How does that happen?
Because the value system changes and the tendencies are no longer there. They used to feed Christians to lions in Rome. You think they'd get away with that today? No.
Well, they're value getting back to it. They're getting back to the gladiators.
The value systems are changing. They have been through time. The more sophisticated we become, the more we access technology.
I agree.
The more scarcity is reduced, the less aberrant behavior will happen.
I agree. Well, I mean, as the economy goes down, crime goes up. I totally agree with you. I agree with about 90% of what you guys are saying.
Well, then we have to take it further then. Once we realize we can create a society, for example, in this society, let's say you wanted to go to the grocery store. Well, guess what? You go in, you get what you need, and you leave. That's it. Why? Why would no one steal? Because there's no reason to. They can't sell it because there's no money. There's no reason for differential advantage in a position where you can't actually engage in gaining something through abuse in society. This is a core point in why money is such a horrible invention for control. I mean, money is the ultimate divide and conquer, Alex.
You're
supposed to be privy to manipulation techniques. The free enterprise system, all the monetary systems are pure divide.
I am privy to music. Here we go. Hold on. Let me explain how this is working here for you. The internet audience is on PrisonPlanet.tv right now. It is huge, hundreds of thousands listening on the web, and then millions over time on the web. So we're skipping AM and FM breaks, shortwave breaks, satellite breaks, and so the audience is probably 10% of what it was, but it is on the air, it is in the view of everyone. All of this is,
I still don't appreciate your insult.
Well, I wasn't implying or apologizing for what I said. I mean, I was explaining, we're on air all the time. Are you even aware you use debate techniques and lawyer tactics, which are extremely dishonest, just like your music, just like your sad music at certain points? Why are you doing that with this corporate Madison Avenue manipulative music like in a drug commercial for Halcyon? Why are you doing that like I am, saying $29.95? Why? Why have you done that?
There's a very big difference because one is art and one is pure marketing. And, of course, you can say there's a matter of degree between the two.
Uh-huh.
But I exchange things in an artistic. I want to make things interesting for people to relate.
Cop out.
They can use their own minds. And, you know, this is the nature of reality. But when you put something on $29.95, it's just a general expression, Alex. It's a very simple notion. It's a marketing tactic. My use of music is music that I like to use.
Uh-huh.
That's period.
Well, I like $29.95.
Well, fine. If that's, you want to have that argument, fine. But you're sitting there along with all the other people in Madison Avenue with the same thing. My music is completely individual.
No, let me explain. We use, with truthful information and truthful good products of information, we use Madison Avenue tactics right back against them.
Fine.
I mean, hold on. Let's talk about you. I mean, don't you work in the whole culture of media? I mean, don't you work in TV?
Yeah, I'm a whore just like everyone else in this system because I have to survive. Yeah.
Oh, good. Well, I just wanted to make sure. But I don't really think of it as...
Okay, go ahead.
No, actually, for the first 6-7 years of my shopping cart, we would say $20. And then I... went ahead and just on air said, I'm now, to show you what Madison Avenue is doing, I actually have been into that, you know, have made the point a lot. And a lot of times, even when I plug, well, I don't even really plug the videos anymore. I never even really spend much time plugging them. But I'm not in some guilt. Hold on. I'm not in some guilt about painting an oil painting of wanting to sell it. Not because I worship a fancy car, because I want a car that drives well and has a good titanium cage. And if I am going to wreck, my children won't be killed. I do like, well, actually, I don't really like nice clothes. I literally have like 50 blue and black t-shirts and blue jeans with holes in them because I like them. But the point is, I'm not into baubles, trinkets, things like that. But I'm not hating materialism. It's just lower on my hierarchy. I don't also go to the extreme of just saying basically anything materialistic is inherently bad. I mean, I need to be able to own my own house. I don't want a bunch of, you know, people in sandals. They're already here stealing farms and ranches everywhere, the phony environmentalists. And then they build giant sky-rises on it and are all filthy rich with armed guards. You know, I also see the whole left thing of, oh, it belongs to everyone. I just see that as very dangerous. Another form of tyranny.
Well, I can see why you see that based on what you've said, and I can understand that angle, but I think we should look beyond these points. You see, ownership itself is based on the restriction of others. I'm not saying that people shouldn't have a home where only they are allowed to go into it. But this protectionist element that comes into play with ownership, property, it has extremely negative influences. And this is one of the central points. You can't have a system where everything is hoarded by everyone else.
Yeah, but Peter, you know who I am. When you called up saying, I officially want to sell this now, so I want to get rights to your film, you know, other people called up threatening you. I knew what you were doing. I didn't call up and threaten because I actually am not very territorial about ideas. I want them out.
Hey, man, I'm not saying that you are.
What I'm saying is I really want to have an intellectual debate with you. I respect you. Think you're very talented. We're back to the full audience right now.
Gotta go north, the rest is on. North to Alaska. Gotta go north, the rest is on.
Okay, I got some other clips of Zeitgeist of Denim I want to play. A lot of you will be checking it out. Most of you have already probably seen it. I would challenge folks from the Zeitgeist crowd, to which I respect and enjoy and think are great, but I also like to argue with people, and I am competitive. I can't help it. I was conditioned that way, and I think a little bit of it's the genetics. In this short segment, for you to say whatever, basically other points you want to make, then I want to play some clips and go through those with you in the next segment, sir.
Okay, well, I can only continue to reiterate my central point, which I don't think has been fully absorbed, and I think everyone listening should seriously consider the reality that human conditioning is the central point. Now, I will jump to the fact that this society that we're talking about can work if people begin to understand what the central elements of it are and how universal these elements are. It's based on the carrying capacity of the Earth. This is not some fantastic notion. It's not something that's not some utopia that someone's inventing. It's not subjective. We want to remove subjectivity and opinion from society to the extent where everything that's created systematically, every system that works in society is derived from a concrete foundation based on the available knowledge, the highest form of available knowledge and technology that we have today. This will never occur in a profit system ever, because it's based on scarcity and reduction and inefficiency, planned obsolescence. We are totally paralyzed. People have no idea how free we could actually be if we allow the fruits of technology to flourish. And then the human value system will undergo incredible change. Will it eradicate all types of aberrant behavior? No, probably not, at least not in any kind of quick time frame whatsoever. However, the pattern and the path is extremely clear. Prisons, police, we buy, these are horrific. We think these are true institutions. If someone does something, they want to throw them in prison. This is the wrong thing. We want to figure out why they did what they did and address the social conditions that create that environment. Our entire society is completely backwards. We can't function this way, and that is the central core of my thesis and what I want people to think about. Human behavior is influenced to a very, very large extent. And this human behavior is the source of the problem. The New World Order will not change until you address the people that are at the very bottom and why they believe what they do.
Oh, I agree. I say every day a lot of the problems are, you know, it's all of us individually. Look in the mirror if you want to know the bottom line problem and the bottom line solution.
Absolutely. The battle is with yourself. I mean, Alex, your whole website is called InfoWars. And I have to say, you know, I understand where you're coming from, because there is a battle going on, and it's important that people stand up for themselves, but this is not an end disposition. There's a reason why peace protesters are met with guys in riot gear and automatic weapons, because they're waiting for something. They want to perpetuate the war system. They want the us against them mentality to flourish, because that's how they maintain control.
Yeah, the teams, and they use the sports teams and all those images to always balkanize us and divide us. Where do you stand on the Second Amendment? There's always going to be bad people that want to hurt good people. Aren't I allowed to have guns?
It is not a matter of allowed to have guns. Is it necessary? And that's the thing I disagree with.
But who's going to decide if it's necessary? Because I assure you,
if there's a need to manufacture a gun, it could happen. However, you're missing the point. You're trying to achieve a system that doesn't have stratification and control. We live in such a stratified control mechanism. There's elitism in every...
Who is going to enforce no one having guns, man?
There's no enforcement. It's based on the understandings and education of what this planet is, who you actually are. This is why I go after religion, because religion is the biggest, most offensive, stagnating element, systematic institution that there is. You cannot have a whole group of people believing in something that stops their intellectual growth. Does that mean they need to be eradicated? Of course not. They need to be educated. Education in our society is completely irrelevant and idiotic. You get an A if you're smart, so to speak. You get an F if you fail. That imposes immediate stratification and immediate competition. The fact is, educational system is a complete joke because they don't take into account the nature of each individual person. True thought is true education is critical thought processes, not retaining information.
Well, I agree. Learning how to think and learning the joys of it. But wait a minute. We've heard all of this stuff about getting rid of test scores, getting rid of that, and it's actually had disastrous effects where it's been tried. I mean.
Sure. That's because people aren't prepared for it. They're not ready for it. And this is something that I want to reiterate again. No one's ready for this. If you took somebody right now and froze them in ice, and you had them rethought out and rejuvenated 1,000 years from now in say a resource-based economy, they would be completely obsolete. They would not know what to do. Their value systems would be, their conditioning would be absolutely obtuse. They wouldn't work. In other words, they'd probably kill themselves or they'd do something extremely defensive, and then something would have to happen. This is a value system issue.
What would have to happen?
Something would have to happen where the person would be reconditioned in some way. That's the point.
Re-educated?
The point is the value systems are too different.
I've heard all this before. That's the problem, Peter Joseph. Peter, I've heard all this before.
What do you mean you've heard it all before?
I mean, I've heard all the stuff you're saying before, and let me tell you, it isn't pretty. I mean, re-educated, reconditioned, oh boy. Oh boy, look out. We're going to skip this break, too, on the internet. Peter, again,
that was out of context, and you know it.
I mean, are you for gun control right now? Are you for gun? Are you for me not being able to own guns right now? Because that perpetual?
I don't have an opinion on gun control because it's such a base disposition. It's based on the assumption that you always have to fight and defend yourself.
Well,
and that is what has to be elevated.
Well, I'm still dealing in the world I'm in. I'm trying to people to think. I want people to identify the system and learn the system and learn how they're being manipulated, and then they can, in a true free society, make decisions through that, and then better ideas, better systems will come to the fore and then become dominant if we didn't have this overarching crime syndicate and we were able to educate the public not to reform it.
Sure, yes. In the interim, yes, you have to have protection elements. This is a system based on differential advantage. You have to protect yourself. That's what the system
And the government
is.
Has more power. The global corrupt corporations are arming themselves against us. So in this paradigm I'm in, I need to be able to defend myself.
I never said that you didn't have to.
I didn't say you did. I was saying what I thought.
Yes, of course. Absolutely. This is the distortion that we currently live in. This system will continue to perpetuate itself until root causes are addressed. Things like tasers. You're sitting there battling these tiny little things, which is good. I think it's great that you go after and you report and you expose all these little things.
We cover it all, though.
They're never, ever going to stop until we adjust the society itself and the environment.
Well, actually, we've called in Austin and San Antonio and Dallas to ban them, and now they're restricting them all over the country and restricting them. The San Antonio police chief just said they're going to take a lot of them away and restrict their use, and so they're being curtailed.
Well, that's good, but I mean, in general, there's always going to be new things that are going to come out. There's always going to be.
Well, here's an example. Bush said we couldn't protest 7 years ago. They lost a bunch of lawsuits. We fought it. Now they're backing off the free speech zones in a lot of areas.
Yeah, sure. So it has its, as I said.
But I'm not battling little things. I mean, this is a 4-hour radio show. We're covering it all. We bring a lot of.
Yes, I'm saying that it's the larger scheme elements that we have to be concerned with. We can continue to deal with this and resolve certain things, exposing 9/11. I'm for all of this.
Well, you're not going to have the material for any type of society you're talking about, and I agree with a lot of it, without having a generally enlightened public, and the mainstream media's not doing that. So I'm trying in my own little way.
Of course, and I'm agreeing with you, Alex. The mainstream media is conditioning people to support the establishment. Everyone's been brainwashed in this system from top to bottom to support the establishment, and that's what has to change. The change has to begin initially inside, and then we have to adjust the environment to support that change. And until that happens, my point is that it's just going to keep happening. There's going to be something else to replace the change. There's going to be another free speech zone.
Well, I have some little 2 and 3 minute. Well, I agree. The evil, the corrupt system continues to generate always more and more of the bad things we're talking about. We're going back live right now. We only got about 27 minutes left. And I got some 2 and 3 minute clips I want to play and then have you comment on them. I think there's 4 of them when we come back. So let's try to play those and then tell folks about your website and how they can buy a video. Here we go.
And the Mississippi River, she's a gold grind. The interest is up and the stock market's down, and you're only getting mugged if you go downtown.
This song is about being self-sufficient, living on your own property. I believe decentralization is the key. We need more Americans to move to the countryside, to become organic farmers, to create communities where they trade and barter together. You know, not big, huge, expansive thoughts that I think are important, but also the little thoughts, the little things that lead in a journey to something better.
I can plow a field all day long. I can catch catfish from dusk till dawn.
But now you can't because they're shutting down the farms and ranches under the phony environmental rules.
Make our own whiskey and our own smoke too.
There aren't too many things these old boys can't do. All right, we are back live with the creator of Zeitgeist, very talented TV editor and producer, Peter Joseph. And working in the corrupt New World Order system, as we all work in it in some way or another, he decided to go out and put it out free on the internet, Zeitgeist. But I do think he should be supported. All alternative films should be. And I think you should, while we're still in this system, buy his DVD. Unless I'm committing a sin here, how do we buy your DVD, Zeitgeist, and then Zeitgeist Addendum?
No, there's no sin committed. You can get it for $5 from zeitgeistmovie.com. I'm going to have the full disc downloadable in a torrent in high resolution, full resolution within a day or two, so you can get the whole thing downloaded and burning yourself.
Okay, fantastic. Let me start getting into these clips or we will run out of time. And I want to have you back again, if you'd grace us, to take phone calls in the next month or so.
Sure.
And overall, this will be positive because it's been an enlightening discussion. And if I said mean things, I didn't mean it to be taken meanly. I'm just an aggressive, conditioned war mock. Let's go ahead and... But I'm a good guy, so that's good that I'm warlike fighting the evil, isn't it? Because if we were all passive, we'd be defeated. But I guess, again, that's my... conditioned? I thought it was my genetics, but I think it's both. Let's play a clip from near the first of Zeitgeist Addendum. That's Zeitgeist 2, I guess, for lack of a better word. This is on money and some other issues like the family. Here it is.
In a world where 1% of the population owns 40% of the planet's wealth, in a world where 34,000 children die every single day from poverty and preventable diseases, and where 50% of the world's population lives on less than $2 a day, one thing is clear. Something is very wrong. And whether we are aware of it or not, the lifeblood of all of our established institutions, and thus society itself, is money. Therefore, understanding this institution of monetary policy is critical to understanding why our lives are the way they are. Unfortunately, economics is often viewed with confusion and boredom. Endless streams of financial jargon coupled with intimidating mathematics quickly deters people from attempts at understanding it. However, the fact is, the complexity associated with the financial system is a mere mask designed to conceal one of the most socially paralyzing structures humanity has ever endured. A number of years ago, the Central Bank of the United States, the Federal Reserve, produced a document entitled Modern Money Mechanics. This publication detailed the institutionalized practice...
Okay, that's enough. That's invaluable information, and he goes through the facts. But to say that these private cartels that sit above the entire world economy, that this fraud is free market... Free market is I raise a bunch of pigs and go and trade them for a bunch of corn to feed more of my pigs, or I'm a gunsmith and I fix somebody's rifle for them, And, you know, they give me a little gold piece or a silver piece. So I just think that compared to all the other systems man's tried to create, I don't think it's fair to call this a free market. What we have is private central banking families coming in, getting control of government, and then using that as an engine to expand their control through empire. And it's a totally unfair system. So, I mean, they are the only ones that can create the symbols that are seen as wealth, and it's just a complete fraud. But, I mean, what's wrong with having a government-issued currency that is controlled and that can be expanded or contracted, but having public education and debate about it so that we can grease the skids of interaction, commerce?
Well, sure. I would say that the corruption, of course, is extremely prevalent, but the difference between what I would argue and what you would argue is probably the fact that the corruption you're seeing now is in fact created by the system itself. It's simply a matter of time because the entire monetary system is based on differential advantage. See, in the early days where you actually bartered for something else, there's less likely to be corruption. Now, insider trading, you know, the general manipulation, planned obsolescence, this is a different world with strategies for profit that do not give a damn about humans at all. The human value is second to monetary gain rampantly. You can see this everywhere.
But how do we even get the public to recognize the Federal Reserve's private and is a fraud? Well, through great films like yours and the Money Masters that we have available, by the way, at InfoWars.com, 3-hour film on the subject to really get deep into it. You know.
Of course, that's why I have it in there. My point, though, is that you have to look at the psychological ramifications of the monetary system. You can't have the system. It's not going to work. The corruption you see, like, for example, Ed Griffin put out this extremely projected review of my film, and he states outright that the free enterprise system is great if it was allowed to work. Well, there's no such thing as the free enterprise system. It never existed. It's never going to exist. We have different stratifications.
But when we see it partially existing or in its pure form, it does create the greatest amount of goods and services and homes and food and medicine for the citizenry.
No, actually, resource management and technology creates those things along with human ingenuity.
Oh, really? Cuba's had resource management?
Cuba? Is that what you said?
Yeah, Cuba's gone more of any Soviet or communist state.
They still have money. They still have the same type of labor system the rest of the world has. This corruption is just the cartels and everything is a matter of time. Monopoly is a matter of time in this system. This is age-old. It's been talked about forever and ever. People don't think about it much anymore, but it's just a matter of time before what I refer to as the world government is world monopoly. You're going to have things. I mean, Walmart is a natural culmination. So people that think Walmart is some kind of, you know, infringing thing that goes into a small town and hurts all the locals.
No, it's the more extreme expression of the parasite. But see, it's not free market. It's using slave goods in select government deals to come in and displace the free market. And so the public became decadent and corrupt and wanted the cheap goods, so they bought into the slavery. So really, Walmart is slavery.
Sure. Well,
just like prisons are slavery.
All labor systems are slavery. Just because how many American corporations do you think are free market? How many of them outsource to other?
They're not slavery. If people get shares in it, if people get stock, if through the brand name, it's known that it can be trusted. Let's play clip two. This is clip two. Here it is from Zeitgeist.
And so if a man makes money selling a certain product, naturally he's going to fight the existence of another product that may threaten his institution. Therefore, people cannot be fair, and people do not trust each other. A guy will come over to you and say, I got just the house you're looking for. He's a salesman. When a doctor says, I think your kidney has to come out, I don't know if he's trying to pay off a yacht or that my kidney has to come out. It's hard in a monetary system to trust people.
All right, stop there for a second. That's human corruption. That is people who only care about themselves. It's an inner thing, and that's why, because you can't trust that and never will be able to, you need to not be so lazy, folks, and go off references or reviews from reviewers you trust for a movie or for a car or for a website or for a film. You know, it takes not being intellectually, individually lazy, and we've been seduced by Madison Avenue into this. But to then just say that, well, finish the clip and we'll go back and get our guest comment on it, the maker's comments.
People, if you came into my store and I said, this lamp that I've got is pretty good, but the lamp next door is much better, I wouldn't be in business very long. It wouldn't work. If I were ethical, it wouldn't work. So when you say industry cares for people, That's not true. They can't afford to be ethical. So your system is not designed to serve the well-being of people. If you still don't understand that, there would be no outsourcing of jobs. If they cared about people.
Okay, let's stop there. We had the U.S. government and the Chinese government 30 years ago make a deal to selectively allow them to have select cadres of corporations make goods, sell poisonous food, do all of it, and the public was brainwashed to basically accept it. But take Ted Anderson, who owns Midas Resources and sells gold and silver. He told me the other day, he said, yeah, a guy called up, and this is off-air stuff, I know I should be saying it, and wanted to buy maple leaves from me, and Ted said, listen, I didn't get a very good deal on these. You really ought to just buy some silver, and I've got a guy that got some silver, and he just gave the guy the number to call it, and the guy was so happy that he got such a good deal, he called back and bought a bunch more gold of a different type. And then Ted, because he gives business to other brokers he knows, just being nice, Ted then, when nobody else can get gold and silver, these big brokers are selling to him because that's not a good old boy network. That's guys, that's Ted wants a good name. Ted wants to be trusted. And he is now, so he's doing very well. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, of course. Well, that's of course going to occur. There's not every single instance is going to be people looking for their self-preservation at that particular moment. However, if Ted was pushed into a corner with elaborate competition from another company that was very, very competitive against his pricing structure, you would see him behave very, very differently. If his livelihood is put in jeopardy, he is going to manipulate his environment to get what he needs.
Nope, Ted almost went out of business 5 years ago. And he still, you know, did it all the right way and came through it and did better than ever. And
good.
I think it's that acquiescence that we're just these, you know, these people programmed by society. I mean, there are good businesses. There are good people.
Sure. But
there are people you can trust.
Differential advantage. It's all based on manipulation advantage. And it's based on humans taking advantage and chiseling off of one another.
That's what humans do. Bad people do that. Good people have to fight them.
That's what this system creates.
That's what we are. Listen, humans made this system. This is what we do.
Now, this is a product of evolution. It's a product of the free market system had its corruptions at the very beginning, and it worked to a certain degree. Now it's time to move forward.
Well, let me ask you this.
Intermediate elements. We need to work on resource management, work with the resources, not the middle elements of money and labor.
Well, I agree with you on that, but before we run out of time, here's an example. You know, we only see a limited part of the light spectrum. The science has shown all these other dimensions. Who knows what lives on other planets? I mean, the point is we have very limited views. What we know today would be total magic 100 years ago or 1,000 years ago. I mean, how can you just say? I mean, I'm certainly religions build a box around it and create priests and get power from it. But I mean, you know, other experiences. You know, the mind within, the soul. You don't believe we have a soul.
Soul based on a traditional definition.
But I mean, how do you know there isn't more? How do you know?
You can't. If you find a whole group of people dancing around a tree, they call it a boo-boo tree, and they sit there and say that this tree has all the power that controls everything, I can't disprove that. I can't disprove it. However, I hold it as extremely improbable.
I'm saying it's a human idea that is central to who we are, and that religion, alchemy, is what developed the sciences, and it's humans knowing there's more. Humans pushing the envelope, reaching out into other dimensions.
It's
and then it manifests through ridiculous boo-boo trees. But I mean, just to disdainfully, I mean, there's all sorts of good things that come out of religion. You know, slavery, you could argue, transatlantic, was started by people misinterpreting the Bible, but then it was people interpreting the Bible who then got slavery banned.
Yes, so what? I'm talking about religion as an institution. This is an arbitrary institution. It's pushed upon you, I guarantee you, bet you $1 million your parents were Christian. You know, this is an environmental distinction. If you were born, again, you say religion is Christ and everything is very important to you, well, guess what? You're born in the Middle East, you have a totally different value system, probably have no relationship to Christ.
The Middle East is about 25% Christian, actually.
Well, you know what I'm saying. If you were born in an Arabic family, dominant religion of the area, This is the reality. We are.
But let me say this. That's actually in a way, it's a healthy firewall because there's new ideas, which are normally old as well, nothing under the sun, repackaged, which are damaging to the family. I think the Arabs saying, we hate your television and your corruptness and your destruction, and obviously they suppress women in their own way, and men as well. But, you know, we don't want to turn our girls into little whores. We don't want to use your drugs. We see your TV, and we call that the great Satan. I mean, in a way, that has allowed them to keep themselves from being dominated by the West. These cultural things we have also have a defensive measure. I'm not saying it's overall positive. I'm saying it has that element. It's there in development.
I totally agree. I happen to personally believe in many of the things that the Christ character has stated. But you know what? I mean, what kind of competition did Christ have? Do you think Christ had guns if he had the option? I mean,
sell your cloak by a sword.
Exactly. But still, you know, if you really look at his teaching, this is a hybrid character. So there's numerous nuances that are going on here that are in dichotomy. But this, what I'm talking about.
Are you saying he didn't even exist, even though the Roman historians and the Jewish historians? You're saying
there are many more Roman historians that have no record of him than there are that say he actually exists. There's maybe four, and they have one line. I'm not going to go into this debate. I've already gone through this 1,000 times. It's on the website.
Well, you did change some stuff in your first edition of your first one. I mean, you did get a few of those gods and things wrong. I mean, you're not infallible either.
Of course not. I never said I was. I do my research as best as I can, and I present what I learn, and this is how we grow as a society. And religion itself rejects this type of education.
Well, here's the deal. Christians see this New World Order system attacking their religion. And let me tell you, whether you believe it or not, the New World Order, by and large, are Satanist. I mean, they worship death and destruction and me, which is the Madison Avenue God. I mean, certainly you're not ignorant. You know that there is an occult empire.
I'm well aware of it, but I don't recognize it with any type of interest because it's no different than anything else. Of course you're going to have these divisionary aspects. I know about the Bohemian Grove. I'm very familiar with all of this. I know about the occult orders. They've existed for a long time. They're just a bunch of little clubs jockeying for their own ideological and personal power, age-old type of thing. But they are all a product of their conditioning. I'm going to keep reiterating this, and I want everybody out there to go to the ZenusProject.com, to go to the ZeitgeistMovement.com, and to think about these ideas and to realize that out of all the things we've talked about, Alex and I, the most important is to realize why people behave the way they do. And I argue that it is not genetics, it is behaviorism based on conditioning. And that is the most important element.
Well, I think that's definitely half of it. We're going to go to break here. Let's go ahead and start playing clip number 3.
War, poverty, corruption, hunger, misery, human suffering will not change in a monetary system. That is, there'll be very little significant change. It's going to take the redesign of our culture, our values, and it has to be related to the carrying capacity of the earth, not some human opinion or some politics.
All right, stop there. We'll play the rest after the break. Let me ask you this question. Who does the redesign and who decides the carrying capacity of the earth? Because the New World Order is going to use a false environmental carrying capacity to tax breathing everything. I mean, you're talking hardcore tyranny.
Well, I'm not interested in the New World Order. They have no position in this type of structure. You can always say there's going to be people that try to mess things up. As I said before, the carrying capacity of the earth is just that, the carrying capacity of the earth.
Oh, really? How do you assess that?
You look at everything that the planet has. You look at the systems that are in operation, just like you would a plot of land to figure out what's capable.
Do you believe global warming's man-made and bad?
I have no opinion on global warming. I've never seen evidence definitively on either side.
It's total crap.
They use it for their own advantage. I don't appreciate that. So, the UN, it's a big joke with these guys. So that's irrelevant to this conversation, though. What I'm talking about is the system.
All right, we're skipping this break. Stay there. Just start over. Go ahead. All right, we're now just on the web. Go ahead.
Parameters of this system are self-evident, and this is something that people have to learn about through Jacques' research to understand what he's talking about, because it's extremely foreign to what most people have tend to understand and been conditioned to believe. We have the ability to harness a structure that is universal and nearly universal based on our understanding, and everything else will culminate because of this. We live in such a distorted society that these opinions and these biases and these religions and these ideologies are so pervasive that no one has any idea what to believe. The fact is, you break it all down, we need food, we need air, we need water, we need the resources of the planet. Simultaneously, we need to realize that technology is our savior and always has been. We just don't give it that name. We don't recognize it as such. As Carl Sagan used to say, we love the gifts of technology, but we reject its methods. And with time, we utilize the methods and have a world based on what we understand, not superstitions and projections and age-old traditions that are no longer needed and are outmoded and irrelevant. The decision-making process, again, I can't go into the exact details because it's a bottom-up capacity type of thing. You relate to it, you build upon it, the conditions become self-evident, and that's what you need to understand. If you've ever researched the scientific method, you'll see that when you build something, all the conditions become apparent as you work. And this is the most important point. It's an empirical understanding based on the natural carrying capacity of the Earth.
Yeah, it's just humans want to differentiate. Humans want to be individual. You know, and that's not an evil, and that's not an evil thing. Well, I mean, can you imagine saying that you're going to build this world when humans do the same thing over and over again instead of acknowledging that we do have faults and do have problems, and you know, trying to teach people to stand up for themselves and go after corrupt systems. I'm just trying to have us survive and do that first. And then I always hear the establishment talking about, you know, pie in the sky. I mean, so much of what you said we heard from the New World Order engineers, and they've built a top-down scientific society. They've used the scientific method. You and your guest in the film, your presenters, I mean, they keep saying over and over again, the elite know nothing. They understand nothing. They don't see it. No, there's a bunch of clips where are you saying in the film it's not said that these politicians can't have solutions because they don't understand the system? And, you know,
We're speaking about politicians themselves. You know,
they call it a scientific dictatorship. They say we're cold-bloodedly, scientifically setting up a hyper-dominant system over the population of the planet.
Yeah,
I mean,
well,
they are saying that they are. I know, I'm saying that your information is going to go out and it's going to be latched onto. This happens to me as well, I'm just saying. And then spun off into a horrid hybrid.
No, well, this is one of those things that you have to defend against to a certain extent when you're dealing with misinformation and ideologies that are misinterpreted. This is, you know, to talk about this is really futile. It's good to recognize it, but this system has a universal implication. It's a natural progression. The
barriers. All right, final segment. Here we go. Final segment. You're saying it's a natural progression for this system to fall apart, to destroy, and then to be rebuilt. And then you're saying the system you're talking about, are you saying that's a natural progression to move into this resource-based system?
Yes, absolutely, because we've finally realized with our technological understanding that resources can be utilized in a way that does not require scarcity. We can have a world of abundance. I mean an abundance. I mean, I don't have time to break it down right now, obviously, but you have to realize the multiplicity of the things.
No, I understand it. The New World Order knows we can have that, and they're doing, and they're setting up a world, they say it, they're setting up a world tyranny to block us from developing that.
I'm not talking about fighting the New World Order. I'm talking about true.
Are you saying that they don't know? Because over and over again in the film, it's said that they don't understand, they don't know. No, they do know that this is possible, and their New World Order will take on many of the things you're saying, but only to get their dominance in to block things that empower the individual and the community.
Well, fine, but nevertheless, their tool is money. If you want to see the New World Order stop, you got to get rid of money. They're not going to have anything else at that point. There's such a small elite, they can't even compare to the power of a group identification with the new social system. They have nothing. The next thing that we have to go after are the military and the police and get them converted, because without them, the New World Order can't do anything.
Have you seen the H.G. Wells film? Have you seen the H.G. Wells film, Things to Come?
Not in many years.
Well, I mean, it's a lot of what you're saying. Let's go ahead and play a clip from that. Big sigh there. I mean, let's play that H.G. Wells clip, Things to Come, John.
But we, who are all that are left of the old engineers and mechanics, have pledged ourselves to salvage the world. We have the airways, all that's left of them. We have the seas. And we have ideas in common. The brotherhood of efficiency. The Freemasonry of science. This is how I conceive our plan of operations. First, the roundup of brigands. That last dismal vestige of ancient predatory soldiery. The last would-be conquerors. Then settle, organize, advance, this zone, then that, and at last, wings over the world, and the new world begins.
And then the film goes on, they go and round up all the evil capitalists, but you're saying that's not what you're saying.
Well, obviously not, Alex. That has no relevance to anything that I've said, and if you look at the research that we've done, that the Venus Project is about, there's no relevance to that whatsoever. There's absolutely no opposition to anything. There is a train of thought that is given in education to people, and they can take it or leave it. And I am of the mind that I think once people recognize this direction, the New World Order, the elitists, the globalists, would not only not have a chance, they will falter and join. And they won't do so because of their own, you know, their own need to try to corrupt the system. People are people. People are products of conditioning, and they want to see themselves live in a capacity which is beneficial to them at their very core. If they've been conditioned into pure corruption, then that's their conditioning, and they will perpetuate that as long as...
Well, I agree to that. I mean, I agree with you on a, to a great extent with what you're saying about that, and that if we build it, they will come. You know, that if people see an alternative throughout the system, they will join it. I'm just saying you're going to find human nature, whatever its cause is, always there, and anybody that tries to override that, that would just create a new tyranny to try to stop it. But overall, I think what you're doing gets people thinking, and that's an important thing. So, Peter Joseph, fire out your websites again.
There's zeitgeistmovie.com. That's the central site for Zeitgeist Project. There's the zeitgeistmovement.com, which we have about 30,000 people joining in about 4 days, which has been very progressive.
And you're going to have the Z Movement, too, Z Day.
Absolutely. And then there's the Venus Project.
The Z Force is here.
We are here to save you. We are here. We are here to free you. You are here. We are here to re-educate you.
No, we'll see what happens with it. Hey, I know you mean well, and you're a great guy. We appreciate you coming on, Peter. Please don't come. Please don't come get me on Z Day. Please, please, no, not that. Not re-education. Not that. No. Hey, take care, bro.
All right, man. Take care.
We'll see you. They will be re-educated. Folks, see Endgame Blueprint for Global Enslavement. There already is a scientific system. It's a scientific dictatorship. Retransmission starts right now. One place, Infowars.com, with power-packed info. Take care.
The system I advocate, a resource-based global economy, is not perfect. It's just a lot better than what we have. We can never achieve perfection.
In order to find the answer, we must first find the true underlying cause. For the fact is, the selfish, corrupt, power, and profit-based groups are not the true source of the problem. They are symptoms.
My name is Jock Fresco. I'm an industrial designer and a social engineer. I'm very much interested in society, in developing a system that might be sustainable for all people. First of all, the word corruption is a monetary invention. That aberrant behavior, behavior that's disruptive to the well-being of people, while you're dealing with human behavior. And human behavior appears to be environmentally determined, meaning if you were raised by the Seminole Indians as a baby, never saw anything else, you'd hold that value system. And this goes for nations, it goes for individuals, for families. They try to indoctrinate their children to their particular faith and their country and make them feel like they're part of that. And they build a society which they call established. They establish a workable point of view and tend to perpetuate that. Whereas all societies are really emergent, not established. And so they fight new ideas that would interfere with the establishment. Governments try to perpetuate that which keeps them in power. People are not elected to political office to change things. They're put there to keep things the way they are. So you see, the basis of corruption is in our society. Let me make it clear. All nations, then, are basically corrupt because they tend to uphold existing institutions. I don't mean to uphold or downgrade all nations, but communism, socialism, fascism, the free enterprise system, and all other subcultures are the same. They are all basically corrupt.
The old appeals to racial, sexual, and religious chauvinism, to rabid nationalist fervor, are beginning not to work.
This is who I am, and whether I'm good or bad or